Hi, and welcome to our session on Decolonizing the Literature Curriculum. I'm Jody Johnson. I'm with the ProQuest Literature Team, and I am just delighted to get to introduce our panel and share our vision with you today. I'm joined by Alice Ng, Electronic Resource Librarian from Wake Forest University, and Roberto Delgadillo, Research Support Services Librarian at the University of California, Davis. We're going to explore the importance of diversity in literary studies in curriculum and collections, and how to enrich and better support online research, teaching, and learning, especially now in a time when our physical locations are closed. To begin, this is a little backwards. We normally close with a thank you, but today we want to open with a thank you. For those of you who are joining us, thank you for your role on the educational front lines. You are helping your users continue to teach and learn and do research in an environment that none of us has ever experienced before. We did have some reservations about holding this webinar, but by the number of people who have registered, we heard loud and clear that people were interested in this topic. They wanted this session. So here we all are. And thank you to each of you who has joined us. Before we begin, I do want to make one last note. We understand that you and your institutions are being stretched in entirely new ways. Please know that ProQuest is here. We are ready to help. Contact your account team or visit support.proquest.com. Follow us on social and check the ProQuest.com homepage to stay on top of any new programs to support coronavirus impacted libraries. And on that note, let's dive in. Our topic today is certainly a broad one. We are talking about a discipline that is tasked with reflecting the whole world. There is no easy task here. It is difficult for libraries to support a range of diverse experiences. Many minority voices remain underrepresented and unheard. But it is essential for our libraries to reflect different cultural experiences so that readers can both see themselves in writings and learn about others from diverse backgrounds. And now, more than ever, during a time of physical distancing, having access to these shared stories can help us feel more connected. So where does the library start? How do you ensure that you are representing lesser-known voices? Today, our two panelists will speak to the importance of equality, diversity, and inclusion within the field of literary studies, and even more broadly in academia. Each speaker is going to share their perspective and their related projects to bring minority authors and unique voices in literature out of the shadows and into the light. We'll also give a sneak peek of our new product, and we'll show how we are helping solve problems of bringing diversity to scholarship and making content more easily accessible, so important now during a time when researchers are looking to stay connected. In creating ProQuest One Literature, we have worked with a variety of people, like our panel, who have been giving us advice. And while we've been having these conversations through the development of ProQuest One Literature, we want to expand the circle. We want to have this dialogue with the literature community. We want to have this conversation with you. So on that note, it is our pleasure to host our speakers today. And I'm going to introduce our first speaker to start us off. This is Alice Ng. She's an electronic resource librarian at Wake Forest University. She has worked as a reference librarian at various public and academic libraries. And aside from her library expertise, she is also a bad TV enthusiast, a Wendy Williams expert, and she loves to run. So Alice, I'm going to pass you the ball, and you may now run with this.
Thanks, Jody. Well, I guess we'll just dive right in. My first slide is me doing a search in ProQuest Central. You can see that there are about a million results, and there's nothing really special or complicated about my search, and it seems pretty average, to be honest. We can see that some of the sources include scholarly journals, books, audio, video. It seems like a good result, honestly. But when you do a deeper dive, one of the things I noticed is that the authors have European-sounding names, and though only three boxes are highlighted here, there are actually five results, but there are more male authors featured than female authors. And so I, as the user, as I look at this, I think I could draw the conclusion that the authority on Native American literature is white men just by looking at this page. So if you do an even deeper dive, you look at the dates of these articles or these records, and they're from the 90s. And I think here, they're highlighted, it's 93, 94, 95, so early to mid 90s. And again, it's hard for me to believe that there hasn't been anything of relevance written about Native American literature since the 1990s. And finally, I'd like to point out this video that was the first result under the video section. The video is of King Kong, and I'm not really sure what Native American literature has to do with King Kong, but I do find it pretty funny that it's the first result in the video section. So how did this happen? As an electronic resources librarian, I have to admit that I'm contributing to this problem. I'd also like to mention that these kinds of results are not unique to ProQuest, and it's an issue that all information searches have, including Google. So I'm going to talk about a few parts of my job and how they contribute to the results we just saw. So how do we find the content that populates a search? A lot of content is purchased based on the recommendations of subject librarians and liaisons. Since they're the subject experts and have the most contact with faculty, I rely on them for their recommendations for resources. Another way to get recommendations is from students and or users. I mean, users are more than just students, they're also faculty. And so one way that we kind of deploy this is through a PDA or DDA model, which I think a lot of people are common with. And looking at reports from PDA and DDA models, you can see what users are telling you that they're using and what they find relevant. And another good thing about PDA and DDA is that it can broadly let you know what subjects users are accessing and what areas could use more attention. And finally, I find recommendations through reviews in trade journals or publication or blogs. The problem I have with reviews and publications is that more mainstream resources are reviewed than niche resources, which doesn't help with a balanced collection. So how do we get to the content? A lot of times we use providers of content. For content and access. Providers of content include ProQuest, EBSCO, and Gale. I think that we're familiar with these big providers. They provide a lot of content for a reasonable price and can serve a lot of different users. They made the prices so attractive, and for the amount of content we get, it's really hard to turn down. And honestly, it's pretty easy to license. Also, the metadata provided by these big providers are usually pretty decent and work well with discovery tools. Another provider of content that we look at are small publishers, which they're great because they offer specialized content, which is good for a more balanced collection. Their content may cost more, but it's usually pretty unique. The problem I think you might run into with smaller publishers is that they may not be included in a knowledge base, which means that their content may not be discoverable in a discovery tool. To make the content discoverable, maybe your library purchases MARC records. When you do this, you're essentially purchasing a company's value system. By this, I mean that records are created by people with their own inherent views and biases, so we have to think about the records we purchase reflecting that. But I'd also like to mention that it's true of every record we incorporate into our collections, even the records that we create in-house. And finally, the database platform itself is where a lot of users start their research. And when we purchase the content, we're usually also purchasing the searching algorithms. Database searches work on algorithms that I don't control or understand. For example, I can't explain that King Kong result and I can't fix it. But I think it's also a great example of purchasing a provider's value system. So I'd like to finish up with how is the content evaluated? So even though I think we'd all like to provide an incredibly balanced and equitable collection, there's a lot of conflicting priorities. One of the big ones that I've seen is the university or external priorities. If you work at a public school, and I used to work at a public school, a lot of our collection money was kind of dictated by the legislature. And I would love to say that we tried to find and work towards a balanced collection, but it was really hard. So if you have a school that's focused on a STEM program, it's unlikely that you're going to be able to put a lot of money into LGBTQ+ content. Users also have expectations of what they need to do their work. I've worked at three different kinds of libraries. One was a proprietary school focused on getting students into the workforce. The last school I worked at was a public university that was teaching-focused and was a teaching college focused on STEM, and I'm now at a private liberal arts school. All these schools have really different users with their own expectations of what they want from the library. And ultimately, if they don't find a resource useful, even if a library sees it as valuable, it can be hard to justify keeping it. Obviously, in the last month, remote access has increased for a lot of databases, and supplementing physical items to make research balanced and equitable isn't really an option. So I think that means that there's more scrutiny on the content and the value and the diversity of electronic resources. I think it's fair to say that budgets will be tight in the near future, but a lot of libraries were already dealing with shrinking budgets, so that's not new for a lot of libraries. No matter how much better it makes a collection, if something is too expensive, there's a chance it gets dropped, especially if it only serves a small user group. I've seen the question of who knows best play out differently at each library I've worked at. Some places, librarians have a bigger say in collection development, and at others, the users dictate the collection. This depends on your library or university, and you may not be consulted for an opinion. As an e-resources librarian, I deal a lot with usage reports. Though it's not the only metric for justification, it does bear some weight. So if a resource can only be used by a small discipline or program and is incredibly expensive, it may be questionable. Even if it's used by that department and adds balance to the collection, that may not be good enough to keep over a cheaper or more interdisciplinary database. And finally, I'd like to close with who is actually qualified to evaluate the narrative of the collection. I know I can't speak for every group and every topic since I don't know about every group and every topic, but I think the thing to remember is that collection development shouldn't happen in a vacuum, and it should include having conversations with vendors and publishers like ProQuest to develop more inclusive products. Ideally, we should all be working towards a more representative collection when possible.
So next, I would like to introduce our next speaker, Roberto Delgadillo. He is a Research Support Services Librarian at University of California, Davis. His research interests basically include pretty much all things interesting: Latin American studies, comics and graphic novels, urban folklore. So Roberto, sir, I invite you to take the mic.
Thank you for joining me today. Pleasure, and nice to see you. Number of familiar faces throughout the attendees and also obviously through the panelists and such. Today, and again, thank you again for joining us. Today, these are some of the topics that I'll be discussing, and you know, due to time constraints, as you can imagine, these are all wonderful of themselves, but I'll touch upon some of these and you know, certainly welcome your questions. Today, basically, I'll be talking about the challenges that a lot of us, I think, obviously, with the current crisis that we are facing, are having to face as they, you know, present themselves as challenges to remote education. And then for a lot of us, obviously, regardless of discipline, how these challenges are impacting upon our mission of inclusion in literature studies, in this case specifically, but I think it is applicable to a number of other disciplines. I'll touch briefly upon some actions and projects that UC Davis specifically is undertaking to kind of bring these unique perspectives forwards, and also how our strategy has evolved and how it may continue to move forward as time goes on. So to begin with, jumped the gun there a little too soon there. You know, obviously, I without having to, you know, beat a dead horse here, we are facing a great deal of challenges when it comes to remote education. You know, a lot of us, whether we of ourselves or the faculty or the students that we are having to contend with, whether in the undergraduate, graduate level, are having to come across those structures, those mechanisms that, while they make remote education possible, really in some cases have a bit of a learning curve. And so that in our case, for example, and I suspect in a lot of your schools, you know, you're still having to contend with a number of challenges that are, you know, continue to keep going. And they're made all the more worse by the fact that, again, you know, those services that we had in the physical library are now having to be attended to remotely. And the time frame for some of these is obviously eating up far more time than would have been the case. And so on top of already wanting to acquire those materials, those whether ephemeral or otherwise, that help us in bringing voices of diversity, equity, in this particular case, literature studies, we have to, for the time being, have to contend with the challenges, that, again, that are thrown before us with respect to remote education. And some of the things that we are talking about when we mention inclusion in the traditional sense is, again, always having to wanting to go out into the community, at least in my particular case, and I suspect for some of you as well too, of wanting to find those materials, those voices, those experiences that capture materials that not only inform properly the literary or literature studies and the voices of those folks of color, but again, those materials that go with it. And in the case of Sacramento, for instance, we have a rich tradition and a process that has been accelerated all the more so with the growth and development of the nearby city of Sacramento. The running joke, I remember when I first got to UC Davis, now over 14 years ago, was that, you know, when compared to other areas in Northern California and Southern California, you know, unfortunately, Sacramento was just not quite there. The Bay Area, I don't need to even speak about the galaxy of diversity that is, you know, presented there, and certainly Southern California, and specifically Los Angeles, where I'm originally from. You know, when compared to what Sacramento had to offer, you know, it at times it kind of seemed as though it was quite barren. But having said that, in the last decade or so, and certainly in the last 5 years, acceleration-wise, Sacramento is now blooming way beyond what I ever, and I'm happy to report, way beyond what I ever could have expected. The city continues to grow, and in part it is fueled by the fact that, you know, the cost of housing in Southern California and certainly in the Bay Area has led to a number of people who perhaps may not have thought of Sacramento, but with this particular growth come new voices, come new interests. And so, you know, one of the challenges that I face now, of course, is continuing the work that I do, which is engaging in and participating, whether in poetry readings or book signings or just, you know, just regular meetings with even student book groups, which I, you know, use as a strategy to, you know, seek out and, you know, hear from the students directly and by extension faculty as well, to see, hey, what are those voices that I may or may not be missing? And then certainly look at those other established collections that may be elsewhere, so that, you know, I then have to think to myself, oh, well, how am I bearing or am I on par to say, for example, those voices or those experiences that are, say, captured by, you know, Cal State Northridge when it comes to the Central American experience, or the labor, you know, the documentation of labor issues as they pertain to, you know, a number of ethnic groups in Southern California by looking at collections that are those that are kept at Cal State LA or Cal State Long Beach or UC Santa Barbara or UC Santa Cruz, where I did my undergraduate studies. You know, I have a wonderful collection of just looking at different places. And then, you know, through the work and a little bit of PR here with one of the groups I belong to, you know, comparing to where I stand, for instance, to the wonderful collections that are kept elsewhere through an organization known as SALAM, and the collections that have been built elsewhere, whether at the University of Michigan, whether at NYU, the University of Florida, University of Texas Austin, so on and so forth, just a galaxy of different places, formats, and, you know, where do they stand and how then do I then inform people like at ProQuest or others to make sure that these voices are then heard, captured, and then quite frankly, you know, having to make the switch of how do I represent those voices both locally and nationally. Now, specifically in Davis, when I think about it, well, that's nice that, Roberto, you're looking at the other role models, but what makes you stand out? How is it that, what is it that Davis has to offer that's different, say, for instance, if I were to focus specifically in the UC system and its sister institutions? Well, in Davis, I'm happy to say that we are looking at a number of projects, but the one that stands out for the time being, which actually is kind of tied into a, if I can spread a little word for it, a conference that I plan to, you know, still have and that's been postponed temporarily. But one of the things that we wish to capture as it pertains to just not the agricultural aspect, but also subsequently you know, associated issues with how it's represented in the literature and such, but those collections as they pertain to the Mexican American or the Latinx experience in the wine country, for instance. We are currently working, one specific project I feel comfortable talking about is our ongoing efforts to acquire, for instance, the collections of a group known as MAVA, which in turn is the Mexican American Vintner Association. And they are a small but growing presence in this particular region, which characteristically is, you know, going to be for the most part agricultural in nature. But they and their experiences, these Mexican American vintners, capture a lot of things that you often see in the literature studies with, you know, respect to depictions of the Brasero experience, whether in fiction or nonfiction, poetry or otherwise. And so we are beginning to see this as we see in more and more students coming from those CSUs, community colleges, that begin to talk about and discuss, you know, for instance, oh, you know, I spent a summer, or my family helped grow these vineyards, if you will. And currently MAVA, if I can even be more specific, is consists temporarily for now just of a little over 30 of these vintners. But when compared to the well over 9,000 vintners that comprise the northern area of various vintners in Sonoma and elsewhere, that, you know, for those of you that are, you know, aficionados of the wine industry, you know, it's a small number, but it continues to grow because these vintners and their children or whoever they influence are beginning to have impacts just beyond Davis. They are beginning to seek out connections internationally, for instance, with our partners that Davis has always had in Latin America, specifically Chile, Brazil, Argentina, and so on and so forth. Other things that are also coming into play, although they just started, but I'm happy to say that, well, actually, unfortunately, that the crisis kind of, in essence, torpedoed these efforts. But I'm happy to say that in Davis, we have now reached the point where we actually now have more students of Puerto Rican descent that it's allowed them to have a student club, which, you know, again, I've been at Davis now, come this November 1st, I'll be 15 years here, we never had before. You know, most of the folks that were attending, you know, for the Chicano studies or Latinx community, if you will, just consisted of Mexican or Mexican American. We never had others of other groups. I mean, you had a smattering here or two, but not enough to generate, say, for example, enough to be able to say, oh, you now have a student group. And I'm happy to say that we now have enough students of Puerto Rican descent, or who are Puerto Rican rather, that we actually now have not just a book club, a student club, and a growing presence. And I've been working with them to help shape and develop what, from other aspects as well too, interests in Afro-Caribbean or Caribbean studies in general. So that's, you know, right now I'm happy to say that it's been worthwhile just in kind of working and having to develop a patience to wait for these communities to grow, which is something also that, in terms of strategy, as I move on to my last point, is something to always keep in mind for those of you who face similar challenges, or for those of you who, you know, who are just starting and find yourselves in these positions. You know, well, how do you go about it? What do you have to do? What are the key takeaways? And the one thing I will say is that, you know, try to engage in those efforts in which you seek out those voices. You know, very often you will find, at least in my experience, I found that, you know, for better or for worse, there were those instances in which the university in the past may not have done such a great job in establishing relations with those communities, that at times these other members may have felt, oh, you purport to speak about our experiences, and yet it is not there. And so, you know, based on my experiences, because previously, before getting here, I was a public librarian, I learned the importance of having to go out in the community and make a presence known, and seeking out these folks and saying, hey, let them know that their voices, their output, if you will, because there's a rich variety of things out there beyond poetry, memoirs, painting, you know, whatever the case may be, and then working with folks like ProQuest and other vendors when the case becomes necessary to be able to say, hey, these are the sort of materials, ephemeral or otherwise, that you want to see reflected in the databases. And it's an ongoing process and it's an ongoing challenge, but it's one that if you devote the time, the effort and patience, more importantly, and then subsequent trust that will emerge from that, you will find that the efforts are well worth it, if anything else. As I said, I hope I'm keeping within the time here, Jody, or whoever may remind me and such. I don't want to go, you know, too out there.
I think that was great. I do want to save time for your next slide, though. Shall I?
Sure, go ahead. Let me see if I can, I forget that I'm the one who's supposed to do this. Forgive me.
Oh, I moved it down.
Oh, okay, thank you.
I didn't. I'm sorry. Because you have the you'll have to advance it.
This is a slide, and these are some of my favorite books when I was asked as part of a teaser, if you will. And this idea I got from a book, a wonderful book that I read many, many years ago, about those books that made an impact, and you had to kind of fill in the blank, if you will, what's the wisest, most memorable, most fearless, however you wish to find it, and so on and so forth. So these are some of my choices, and they're a small one. And when I think about it, feel free to contact me off on email afterwards if you wish. But these are, in my own way, when I begin a conversation and discussing with the communities that I've just discussed, and this is not by all means a static list. Those of you who know me among the attendees know that I read quite a bit, and although that's not necessarily a requirement these days, you know, for some of the facets involved in librarianship, it is something that for me is very personal. And so these were those special kind of books that led to my formation, not just as a librarian, but my other experiences, education-wise. And so, you know, I like to just share these as a way to partake, if you will. And I guess I'll end at this point then by moving on by simply saying that please feel free to contact me. I'll make sure that my contact information is made available for those of you who may have had questions. And I love having these discussions. It's the sort of thing, unfortunately, that time constraints prevent you from being able to really get into it. But I look forward to hearing from some of you and wish you very well as you work toward establishing some or confronting some of the issues that we have mentioned and such. To all of you, have a good day and pleasure meeting you.
Well, don't go anywhere yet, Robert.
Oh, no, I'm not going anywhere. No,
questions
no, no.
For you. And on that note, our speakers have touched on the challenges in teaching, challenges associated with creating library collections, some issues that are presented when collection development is skewed. So we would like to open the floor for questions to our panel. So if we have some attendees out there who have questions that they would like to pose to the panel, feel free to drop those into the chat block and we will pass those right over. I do see some questions about looking for some digital sources. And let's see, Roberto, do you have any targets?
In terms of, you mean for digital sources and such, or? Well, the ones that I periodically, and I have alluded to this very briefly, however, is that I often will look at see what my colleagues are helping to develop within this organization I mentioned all too briefly called SALAM, which is an acronym for an organization known as the Seminar for the Acquisition of Latin American Materials. And increasingly and traditionally, although that group consisted of what we would call Latin Americanists, some of the members are increasingly having to acquire or have acquired responsibilities for those areas that involve Chicano studies or Latinx studies. And I find that some of my colleagues at various institutions, private or public, are developing wonderful collections. So from time to time, I will look at and see, oh, what have, you know, what has the University of Texas Austin developed? What has the University of Michigan developed? What is Princeton, you know, digitizing or having as part of its collections? And so I often look at those to see kind of, you know, see and, you know, generate ideas. Another one that sometimes is not looked at, but which I definitely highly recommend, is the Library of Congress. They have wonderful collections there of, you know, not just print, obviously, but, you know, public materials as well, too. Other libraries or regions that I look at as inspiration, and to look at those universities and institutions that are in the Southeast, just because, you know, over the years and such, you know, they have developed those collections or have experiences with those ethnic groups that, or again, states that one, you know, would not have thought about, say, for instance, you know, 20, 30 years ago. I mean, generally speaking, not to, you know, take it for granted, but, you know, in many ways, the starting point, which of in itself is quite a lot, you know, is if you want to look at the Mexican American or the Mexican experience, then you look traditionally, obviously, geographically, obviously look at the Southwest. But what interests me sometimes is that I like to look for those groups of those areas where I ask myself, wow, I didn't know they were there. You know, for instance, I was having a conversation the other day with someone about looking more closely now, and it's been there for a while, actually, but looking more closely to see, oh, what are institutions in Alaska having with respect to the presence of Mexican American workers there or other Latino, Latinx voices? Because you're thinking Alaska is like, yep, they're there, you know, they're there or their children are there. And, you know, they all follow the patterns like other groups have in terms of, you know, they will work, but their children, you know, the folks that are currently there are going to work really hard to make sure their children, you know, be part of that particular region and that land and that identity. And then looking then, and I guess in this instance, I have to pay even more close attention because I'm also responsible, relatively speaking, as the newly assigned or recently assigned bibliographer for Native American studies. And that's an area that I am still way still informing myself upon. Mm-hmm. So I look forward to looking at this and, you know, with excitement, but getting back to the original question as to where to look for those collections. I tend to look at those regions and those collections and ask myself, well, what do they have here? You know, through either live guides or, you know, even looking at the university library websites, you know, what do they have announcement-wise? Are they having author events? You know, whom are they representing? So on and so forth. I know it may not capture or may have not have answered what was initially asked, but I hope this helps. So.
Oh, that definitely makes a lot of sense. Yeah, thank you for sharing that. And while we are doing these questions, we are having a lot of people asking to see the slide of books again. So while we are still on the question and answer part, I'm just going to have this slide up so anyone who wants to capture these stories, these books can. We had a question come in about equality versus equity. Alice, would you be able to speak to that?
I will try my best. Of course, I also invite Roberto to give his opinion on this. But
sure.
From my understanding or how I view it, the way I view equality, that's kind of the idea that everyone gets the same thing. So like I would get two oranges, Roberto would get two oranges, Jody would get two oranges, and that would be equality. In terms of equity, that is, I think, more along the lines of recognizing that we all have different needs and we all have different things we need to get on the field together. So for instance, if I have an allergy to citrus, I probably don't care that I would get two oranges, but I still need vitamin C, I guess. And so there's got to be a different way that I can still get what I need, even though it may be in a different form, if that kind of makes sense.
Yes, that definitely does. And Alice, I'm actually going to tag you again here for this one. This one came in for you specifically.
Okay.
What are some of the publishers that you have found most responsive to your efforts at encouraging underrepresented voices to publish more?
You know, I have a list in my bookmarks of things that I look at, and I, of course, am blanking out right now of exactly who they are, and I apologize. But
if someone wants to spot there.
Yeah, that's, I mean, but whoever asked that, if they want to contact me offline, that's fine. I would welcome that. Honestly, a lot of times how I find these niche or more underrepresented resources is honestly just like talking to people, like going to conferences. If someone offers a really great session on, you know, the niche publishers or refers to something that I've never heard of, like I really don't have a problem just going up and saying, hey, can you tell me more about it? I think a part of that is that people want to talk about it more and they want to get the word out. And I just go around and I keep asking, or I ask friends and I ask for referrals. And I am an electronic resources librarian, so I don't really have as much contact with faculty, but I feel like most librarians are really good about sharing the information they know about, especially about things that are underrepresented or not as mainstream. So I often look to my peers and my colleagues for that. But yeah, whoever asks, if you want to contact me offline, I'll share what I have bookmarked on my computer with you.
I would like to second that as well, too, in terms of I kind of do the same, and I see, looking at the little chat box here, some questions from, you know, folks that are asking what I hope that will help in this regard, too, that, you know, how do I go about finding or, you know, being familiar with some of these collections? I will have to say that Salam and another group that I'm also, I worked with in the past and very happy to be a part of is Reforma. And you will find that they will often include lists, or the members will lead you to those vendors, those publishers that make their presence known, and in getting to know them as well too, because they often have a different take on things. They're more, you know, boots on the ground, if you will, in terms of experience and being able to tell you, oh, you may be aware of this particular publisher, or this particular publisher is now focused on this or that. And you know, I find in conversations with some of the vendors within Salam and some of the ones that are, you know, in Reforma are also wonderful sources of information that help inform, you know, what is out there, or they may be available or might say, well, you know, we are aware of this project that would not fit the, say, the confines of what it is that we publish, but maybe you might know someone. So in some cases, it's word of mouth. And then just networking, just getting to know, you know, it is amazing to me how you will just find and come away with a richness of information that you may not have had just by simply, you know, sitting down and just getting to know some of these publishers. I know, you know, in the context of those who attend conferences or book fairs that, you know, after a while, too much shop talk can get a little bit too much, but if anything else, it's just wonderful. You really come away with it, you know, knowing, and it's there as I look at, say, for instance, some of the questions within the chat, you know, when they ask, well, you know, what terms should I use? How should I categorize it? What will make the best sense? Because, you know, when it comes to this, you know, it is kind of tricky at times, you know, especially when you're using or wanting to identify, well, what terms should I use? It is still, oh boy, you know, as I said, just such a big challenge. And of course, then having those being made available beyond print is also one of the other challenges that can be a separate conversation altogether. But I certainly think that the current crisis is forcing a lot of vendors, publishers, and so on and so forth, others that are involved, to have to think about, like, oh, you know, these materials are, you know, we're going to have to think about how do we get our word out, if you will, and maybe start taking advantage of those other technologies that we may not have thought about, or something to think about as we produce, you know, whether it be poetry, whether it be multimedia projects or whatnot, that, you know, would be of interest to folks like me and others that I then work with and try to connect in terms of research needs and or interests.
Thank you.
Sure.
Guys, there are really fascinating questions that are pouring in. Thank you so much for everyone who's participating with these. If we don't have time, and I know we won't, to get to all of these questions, we will try to reach out to you in order to make sure that you get the answers. One question that I saw came in and I'm very curious about, and I'd like to pose it to each of you. In your research and in your library, do you see a glaring area of an underserved population?
For me, one that is still certainly one that, I mean, I guess I tend to pay more attention to it because I for me, it affects me personally. But I think I have not seen what I would have thought would have been an increase in the number of disabled Latino students. I am disabled, for instance, and I would have thought that over the years, one of the things that I've been also involved with is developing the research group at UC Davis as it pertains to those issues regarding to disability studies. And in the last 10 years or so, you know, Davis is well on the way, although some would assert that we're already as being an institution that in essence is basically, well, rather has acquired rather the designation as a Hispanic serving institution, which is common, you know, until recently was more common to be found in the CSU system and the California Community College. And by CSU, by the way, for those of you who are outside of California, I'm referring to the California State University system, which is the system that is, below or lower, although I would contend in some institutions is above the UC system when it comes to its collections and or interests. But those were characteristically the case. And Davis is there. And I thought, oh, okay, I should be able to see far more, disabled or students that are, you know, impacted by, if you will, the various issues. But I've not.
Uh-huh.
And so that to me is something that I'm still kind of keeping an eye out, if you will.
Yeah.
Yeah, actually, it's funny. My mind went in 1,000 different directions. So I certainly don't want to dismiss any group or anything. But, you know, I also agree that disabilities seem to be missing, as well as, and maybe this is my own experience and certainly not reflective of every library that might have strong collections. But things like neurodiversity, I don't see tons and tons of that. I think that those kinds of alternative diversities are kind of lacking in a lot of collections.
That is really fascinating. Thank you. Thank you for sharing that. And Roberto, thank you for sharing yours as well.
Oh, thank you. And for those of you that I see on the chat, I will get back to you. You're asking great and excellent questions. And I will get, yes, I see. There are just so many. I'm like, I keep mentally and writing down who I need to get back to, and either phone, Skype, or what have you. But I will get to your questions. Thank you. They're excellent questions.
Yeah, this has been very encouraging to see so much participation and all of these really great questions coming in. And as much as I hate to break away from the questions, I want to have a chance to show off our new product. There is no doubt that the study of literature is evolving. There was a need for a singular destination that can bring together content that users may not even know exist. So in order to truly represent the myriad of voices, these voices need to be under one roof. Previously, access to more narrow discipline-specific databases and multi-format content was scattered between various URLs and multiple products and platforms that could function differently. But by introducing this content into a singular destination, we're making strides in the right direction of making material more accessible and highlighting voices that have long been marginalized. So let's just quickly spin around this wheel and let's look at the content of ProQuest One literature. We're bringing diverse voices, 150,000 rare and hard to find texts from Black writers and authors in various regions around the world. Presenting lesser known voices in the same space as the Western canon gives researchers and readers more choice. This also supports diversity and scholarship. We're providing the very best literature that we have across the entire ProQuest portfolio. We're combining literature online, core text, if you're familiar with those, with Alexander Street primary text collections and Chadwick Healy content. With 500,000 works, this is the largest, most inclusive library of text assembled across poetry, prose, and drama. We've incorporated 1,200 of the top literary publications, including journals, bulletins, reviews, and others, 20,000 sources of historic criticism, essays, commentaries related to literature. This is really leaving no stone unturned. More than 14,000 full-text dissertations published in the last 5 years. This shows new and emerging research. Access to 20,000 literature-specific ebooks that cover literature, linguistics, and languages. 18,000 reference works to provide background and context around genres and works. And lastly, video and audio content. Thousands of performances and author interviews. These are from Poets on Screen and the Alexander Street streaming video collections. These not only help bring these primary texts to life, it's exciting, but they demonstrate different interpretations of works in multi-format media. So these different formats all connect stories and they connect people. So all this to say, from the onset, we're listening, we're making changes, and I'd like to demonstrate that. So I went into ProQuest One Literature and I replicated Alice's initial search. So let's take a look. Now, as we perform that same search for Native American literature, we see that this consolidation of materials into a single experience driven by literature-specific indexing gives an entirely new experience. Now, when running that same search, we see names that we might expect to see. Hyde Erdich, who is an Ojibwe writer from the Midwest. Here's Leslie Silko, a Native American writer of the Laguna Pueblo tribe. Jerome Rothenberg is on here, a famed ethnopoet. When we look at some of the dates that are returning, we can see more current content. Here's 2013, 2014, 2016. And lastly, as we pull up our video results, I, for one, am very relieved not to see King Kong popping up in these results. So the difference in these searches is that ProQuest One Literature revolves around a discipline user experience. This means that the platform utilizes literature-specific indexing centered around literary movement, author, and work pages. And here are examples of those pages. These pages help enable connections across literary, cultural, and historical themes. They act as jumping-off points for assignments. And they're essentially tying content together in more usable ways for researchers. Each one of these pages has its own URL, so it can be linked to a LibGuide or course instruction. These are easily accessible for remote users and for distance learning, which is so important just now more than ever. Here's an example of an author page, where the related content is segmented so users can easily find links related to supporting content. So as users look down through the author page, they will be easily linking to journals that support their study, reference materials, dissertations, and video content. Lastly, this is a destination for the literature community. It is important for us to open up these conversations on a larger scale, and we welcome collaboration and feedback from you to help lead the way. One way that we're doing this is through an online feedback forum, Idea Exchange, where we're capturing ideas that will help influence future development of this platform. So I invite you, join us, help evaluate ProQuest One Literature, and share your ideas with us. You certainly have a ton of great ideas that we have seen come in through our question and answer segment. So on that note, Thank you to our panelists for your contributions. Your depth of understanding has really benefited all of us. Thank you to each of you out there who has joined us virtually today. It is so encouraging to see all of this interaction despite the distance. We will send a recording of today's session around, but we would love to keep the conversation going. We do have another webinar next week with a deeper dive into the product, so feel free to join us there or follow the URL on screen to sign up and learn more. Thanks so much for joining us.